नाना शास्त्र विचारणैक निपुणौ सद्धर्म संस्थापकौ लोकानां हितकारिणौ त्रिभुवने मान्यौ शरण्याकरौ राधा कृष्ण पदारविन्द भजनानन्दे नमत्तालिकौ वन्दे रूप सनातनौ रघुयुगौ श्रीजीव गोपालकौ.
So we'll recite the first six verses of invocation, subject of the study of the book, as well as the benedictions offered for the students.
Akhila rasamrita murtihi prasru mararu chiru dhataraka palihi kalita shama lalito radha preyan vidhur jayati Hrudeyasya prerananya pravartitoham varakarupopi tasya hare padakamalam vande chaitanya devasya vishrama mandiratyatasya sanatanatanor madishasya Bhakti-rasamrita-sindhur Bhavatu-sadayam-pramodaya Bhakti-rasamrita-sindhau Charatah-paribhuta-kala-jala-bhiyaha Bhaktam-akaran-ashilita-muktin Nadikan namasami Mimamsaka badavagnehe Kathinam api kunthayannasau Spurato sanatana suchiram Tava bhakti rasamrutam bodhihi Bhakti rasasya prastutir Akhila jagan mangala prasangasya Adnenapi mayasya Kriyate surudam pramodaya
Hare Krishna.
Amazing sight. It's like a sangam of two stalwart batches of devotees coming from every nook and corner of Pune, practically. Thank you very much for coming and encouraging. We are today about to begin one of the most auspicious of all literatures, study. This Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, I personally do not have any qualification to even begin to speak anything about this. That's why I'm going to try my best to simply repeat what every other Acharya following in the footsteps of Rupa Goswami and also the ISKCON Guru Vrinda, under whose feet I have studied this subject matter. I'll just try and repeat what they have said. This subject matter is most elevated in the whole creation of Lord Brahma. It is not like studying any other knowledge. In fact, even Krishna is bewildered trying to understand what is Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. That's why he comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, to understand at least something about it. Because this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is completely the domain of Srimati Radharani. When Lord Krishna appears as a fish incarnation, we call him Matsyavatar. When the Lord appears as sound vibration. We call that as Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. When the Lord appears as a book, we call that as Srimad Bhagavatam. Similarly, when Srimati Radharani appears as a book, that is called Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And this is why, to begin to comprehend the subject matter of this, we sincerely need mercy of Srimati Radharani, all her associates, and especially Rupa Goswami, the compiler, who borrowed the content of this book from Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Radha Krishna combined, in one form. And eventually it is being handed down very carefully up to Srila Prabhupada by various acharyas. So it is our great privilege and also a great opportunity to make spiritual advancement by understanding this literature. So what we would like to do is, we would like to go between the book and the actual Sanskrit text. And you may have to bear with me for doing that. That is just to make sure that our study has become more scrutinizing. And we actually start appreciating the way Prabhupada gives his summary study of this book. Earlier books that Prabhupada has translated, they are not, they are word for word, and they are what we call it. You know, the word-to-word meaning, translation, purport, you know, in that format. What do you mean summary study? Summary study means, Prabhupada gave two interesting insights. Summary study means, first of all, Prabhupada is taking the liberty of highlighting certain sections of this book that are most suited for our spiritual development, and only mentioning, not elaborating, certain sections which may not be immediate use for us. In short, Prabhupada says, I can do as I like as a teacher to my students. So that's one meaning of summary study. Another meaning of summary study is that Prabhupada is taking a free hand in terms of inserting his personal purports embedded in the flow of the book itself. So there is no separate arrangement for word-to-word translation, purport, nothing like that. It is just all in one, you know, format. So we would like to begin today with the preface of the book. Just before that, we will quickly go through the contents. So if you see the contents index of the book, this part 1, 2, 3 and 4, of which for Bhakti Shastri course there is only part 1 to be studied. That is 19 chapters. So I don't know whether you are happy about it, or we should be actually miserable about it, that we are not studying the whole book. One of the reasons for that is the later parts are little elevated in terms of their depth of information about bhakti, and also require certain degree of purification of heart to start appreciating them. So the first part is called Samanya Bhakti, general description of the bhakti yoga. Then Bhava Bhakti, Prema Bhakti, in nutshell, just overview kind of. But later parts are more in depth about Bhava Bhakti and Prema Bhakti. So therefore we are not supposed to study without completely undergoing the part 1, the rest of the parts of this book. Generally in our ISKCON, I have not heard this as an official statement, but in general the mood is, after Brahman initiation, having chanted your Gayatri, lived in mode of goodness for a while and starting to appreciate who Krishna and Radharani is, then one may delve into the higher topics, so as to avoid committing any offenses, or so as to avoid getting bewildered oneself. So the part 1 is going to be our discussion for all the coming few sessions. Maybe within 20 sessions or so we will complete 6 months. And we would like to make sure that whatever Srila Prabhupada is presenting here is also reflected in terms of its sutra for memorization here in the Sanskrit. So we will just give some highlights like that, back and forth. So we would begin with preface. So the first paragraph talks about the history of the author and his coming to the position of writing this book. Second paragraph. Lord Chaitanya's principle is universal. What is that universal? Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. These are the original principles given. The principle of Lord Chaitanya's movement is in educating and elevating everyone to the exalted post of a Goswami is taught in the Nectar of Devotion. So we just now completed our study of Nectar of Instruction. There we also saw that first step is to become a Goswami, then to become a pure devotee. So one has to work in the beginning on strenuously controlling one's mind and senses and engaging them through Vaidhi Sadhana Bhakti. At an elevated stage, we go to the level of discussing and delving directly into pure devotional service. So it continues how Rupa Goswami first met Lord Chaitanya at Prayag, and there at Dashashwamedha Bathing Ghat, 10 days Lord Chaitanya instructed Rupa Goswami personally. These teachings are narrated in Teachings of Lord Chaitanya by Prabhupada, another book. Later Srila Rupa Goswami Prabhupada elaborated the teachings of Lord with profound knowledge of the revealed scriptures and authoritative references from various Vedic literatures. So having heard Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Rupa Goswami started building up a thesis or a treatise on the science of Bhakti Yoga. So he would make a statement based on the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, and that statement he would substantiate from all over the Vedic literatures. Most apt verses that you can pick up. So you make a statement, then you substantiate it. You make a statement, then you substantiate it. In this fashion, the entire book flows. Recently we did research in EMED. So there also something similar is being done. Every time you make a statement, you have to give references. Who said where, what? Earlier proof of this being true. Something similar Rupa Goswami is doing here in the book. So I'm reading fifth paragraph of the preface. Srila Srinivas Acharya describes in this prayers of six Goswamis that they were all highly learned scholars, not only in Sanskrit, but also in Persian, Arabic. They very scrutinizingly studied all the Vedic scriptures in order to establish the cult of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on the authorized principles of Vedic knowledge. The present Krishna consciousness movement is also based on the authority of Srila Rupa Goswami Prabhupada. We are therefore generally known as Rupanugas. It is only for our guidance that Srila Rupa Goswami prepared his book, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Persons engaged in the Krishna consciousness movement may take advantage of this great literature and be very solidly situated in Krishna consciousness. So anytime your Krishna consciousness is not so solid, where do you go? This book. And from this point onwards begins Prabhupada in his full form. Because now Prabhupada is going to get free hand. First of all, it's summary study. I can do as I like. And on top of that, the book is about Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So there is nothing to be hold back in terms of what can you offer to the audience. Earlier, you may have to make some point, you know, giving logic, reasoning this way, that way. But now henceforth Prabhupada becomes very direct about everything that he has got to say in Bhakti Yoga. So we are going to read most of the time, and sometimes I am going to give an explanation, because each of the statements that Prabhupada has written has a power to transform our complete outlook of life and our practices within it. Bhakti means devotional service. Every service has some attractive feature which drives the servitor progressively on and on. Every one of us within this world is perpetually engaged in some sort of service. Perpetually. Even now while you are sitting, when you are at home, when you are in your office, when you are just walking down the road, there is something you are doing about serving someone. And if you don't have anybody, you are at least serving your own mind and senses. And the impetus for such service is the pleasure we derive from it. So what impels us to do service? Pleasure that we derive out of it. Driven by affection for his wife and children, a family man works day and night. A philanthropist works in the same way for love of the greater family, Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. And a nationalist for the cause of his country and countrymen. So three examples: family man, philanthropist, nationalist. Prabhupada is taking from where we are at to where we are supposed to be. You begin with what is known. So everybody is doing service, and the impetus for their service is the pleasure they are deriving out of it. That's called rasa. That force which drives the philanthropist, the householder, and the nationalist is called rasa. A kind of mellow relationship whose taste is very sweet. So how many of you experienced rasa in some form or other? Good. Bhakti rasa is a mellow different from the ordinary rasa enjoyed by mundane workers. Mundane workers labor very hard day and night in order to relish a certain kind of rasa, which is understood as sense gratification. So whatever the slogans are, Ye Dil Mange More, any of the advertisements? Just do it. And? Yehi Hai Right Choice Baby. So all these slogans are talking about what? Mundane rasa. That you, if you take this product, you take to this whatever situation, you are going to get the best of rasa in your life. That's the proposal. And this is what drives the whole material world. Everyone is busily engaged in relishing mundane rasa. Now, the relish or taste of the mundane rasa does not long endure. Therefore, mundane workers are always apt to change their position of enjoyment. So there are three problems which Prabhupada will talk about in mundane rasa. First problem is called bhogatyaga. One enjoys that rasa for a while and he becomes disgusted with it eventually and wants to change the platform of enjoyment. So that is called bhoga tyaga. Second problem is chapala sukha. The quantum of pleasure experienced is very flickering. In mundane rasa, the amount of enjoyment you get is very meager. And thirdly, mundane rasa is terminated at the time of death. You cannot carry it forward. So death terminates it. Exactly opposite of this mundane rasa is bhakti rasa. In bhakti rasa, there is no bhoga, no tyaga. Whatever you are right now relishing, you can continue relishing that same thing for all time to come. So, that's first. No bhoga tyaga. Second, there is no chapala sukh. It is actually, how do you call it? Long-lasting sukh. Every relish of bhakti rasa has a perpetual satisfaction that it leads to. And lastly, it doesn't get terminated by death. Bhakti rasa continues further. So these are the three essential points Prabhupada would make throughout in the lines to come. Now Prabhupada gives the example of bhogatyaga. A businessman is not satisfied by working the whole week. Therefore, wanting a change for the weekend, he goes to a place where he tries to forget his business activities. And then after the weekend is spent in forgetfulness, he again changes his position, resumes his actual business activities. Bola, bahut maza kar liya. We have to come back to our regular activities. Material engagement means accepting a particular status for some time and then changing it. This position of changing back and forth is technically known as bhogatyaga, which means a position of alternating sense enjoyment and renunciation. So any examples in our life where we have gone through this? One at a time. Okay. After seeing Lonawala once, nobody goes there again. Usually that also happens. That platform is over practically. Any other?
Sometimes we have a feast and then we decide we not have any more food because we overeat, and then next time again.
Yeah. In Krishna consciousness we overeat and then bahut kha liya, iske aage I have to be careful, I will not overeat. But we forget after a while, again go back. Any other? Bhogatyaga. Okay, you work hard and you want to party harder. Okay. The point I'm trying to make is, the very same object or situation or person that you wanted to enjoy, over a period of time becomes distasteful and disgusting. And you want to give it up. The same thing. We are not talking changing anything. Like we gave the example of rasgulla. When you eat one rasgulla, very nice. 2, 5, 10, 20, 50. The same rasgulla becomes so painful. Rasgulla has not changed. Nothing has changed about it. So what has gone wrong? That's the way the mundane rasa affects our consciousness. It makes us hanker after it in the beginning. And the very same thing that we are hankered after, we get disgusted with it after some time. Yes. Diseases.
Living in this body, okay. Usually in the young age.
Okay, in young age the body is giving some pleasure, so we want to grab as much as we can. But as the old age comes, body takes back everything, soot samet vapas. Whatever we enjoyed and exploited with the body, that same we have to pay back in old age by serving the body in horrible ways. Yes. Yes. I remember in my early days, Marathi poetry was very dear to my heart. But over a period of time, the same songs, the same poetry eventually became not so tasteful. The one example I was looking for is movie songs. Oh. The top 10 movie song, when the first time the lyrics are released and the thumping beats are released, everybody is just swaying to the whole thing. And you hear it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 50 times. Then after that you say no more. Get another song. And this is how it continues. Exactly opposite of that is our spiritual songs. Every morning we sing the same song. Samsara dava nalalidha loka tranaya karunya ghana ghanatvam praptasya kalyana gunarna vasya vande guru shri charanaravindam. And the more we absorbedly sing that song, the more we relish the meaning, the flavors, the connection that it offers to Guru. So this is a proof. No bhoga tyaga in bhakti rasa. Our platform of enjoyment doesn't change. It's not like, oh, kitne bare Hare Krishna mantra, ekik mantra kya? You know, change this after some time. Or you sing the same song also in the same tune only. At least change the tune. Somebody may say. Say no. Same tune. Same literature. Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavatam. No change. Even one verse of Bhagavad Gita, one can just go on relishing for whole time to come. So this is a proof of bhakti rasa lacking the quality of bhoga tyaga. Then comes chapala sukh. Prabhupada gives that explanation. Sense gratification does not endure long. For example, an ordinary family man who works very hard day and night and is successful in giving comforts to the members of his family, thereby relishes a kind of mellow. But his whole advancement of material happiness immediately terminates along with his body as soon as his life is over. Last line in the same paragraph. In any field of activity, political, social, national, international, the result of our actions will be finished with the end of life, that is sure. So chapala sukha, very interesting topic to discuss. In material world, much of the pleasure is advertised, but very little is experienced. We give that example of somebody who is in a desert, super hot sun on the head, parched throat, hankering after water. Finally, he sees a helicopter coming. You know, and the helicopter is blue helicopter with words, dark blue words, water written on it. And so, wow! And the helicopter comes and the person gets down through a stair that he hangs down. And he comes just right next to him. And he is excited. And he says, you want water? And this person says, yes, very desperately. And he takes out that dropper. And he, you know, on his hand, he gives one drop. And he puts the dropper back in the pocket, goes back, the helicopter goes. How would this person feel? You know, he's thirsting for water. Somebody comes, gives a drop. This is exactly how material life is. Much is advertised, very little is experienced. When we actually go for enjoying it, we realize, oh no, isme kuch hai nahi. And some of the best enjoyments of material life are like that. You know, including sex pleasure. It is heartbreakingly brief and pathetically meager. Heartbreakingly brief means what? It is so brief, you feel itne khatam. You know, you expected so much around it, but just didn't happen much. And pathetically meager. The brief talks about duration of time, and meager talks about the quantum of pleasure, quantity of pleasure. Both are insignificant. And this is the problem with chapala sukha. And most of that pleasure is also in imagination. It actually doesn't exist. And the classic example of that is when we plan for our trip. You know, we will go to Goa, you know, some Maldives or some place like that. So all the pleasure that exists is in planning stage. You know, we'll go to Goa, there will be a beach, there will be sunshine. There will be such nice waves of the ocean coming and we will swim, you know, this way, that way. Maybe we will do surfing also. There is all pleasure in mind. Manasijam. Mental concoction. You actually go to Goa, the beach is dirty. Sometimes people have passed some stool, it's stinking. And, you know, the waves are too pounding. You know, you try and go swim there, they hit you so bad. You know, you get some broken bones or something. You know. And then you come out on the beach, then some beggars come, hey, paisa, paisa dona, you know. And you get irritated by them, you know, where is the enjoyment? You wonder. So the reality is very different. So in this way, most of our time goes in this manasijam business where we are thinking of enjoying. But when we actually get the opportunity, material nature somehow tricks us and makes a fool out of us. And this is why chapala sukha is another nature of material pleasure, mundane rasa. Knowing this, what does a devotee do? Tyaga chanti ranantaram. Just don't do it. Don't entertain. No need of getting wasting your time into that business. So that is the mood. So we come to Bhakti Rasa. Next page. Bhakti Rasa, however, the mellow relished in the transcendental loving service of the Lord, does not finish with the end of life. It continues perpetually. Therefore, it is called Amrita. So Prabhupada gave the explanation of the term Bhakti Rasa first. Then now he is explaining Amrita. Then he will explain Sindhu. Bhakti Rasa, Amrita, Sindhu. That's what is going on in the preface. So somebody may say, why take to Bhakti Rasa? I am happy in my material life. So Prabhupada said, wait a minute. This is your problem. Bhogatya, Chapal Sukh, terminated by death. Here is another alternative. No more Bhogatya. It is Sindhu-like pleasure, not Chapala Sukh, not flickering. Oceanic pleasure. And cannot be terminated by death. You can continue perpetually enjoying it. Would you like this option? So yes. That's what is going on in the preface. That's what Prabhupada is doing. So Bhagavad Gita says that a little advancement in Bhakti Rasa can save the devotee from the greatest danger. Which verse? Neha Bhikrama Nashosti Pratyavayo Na Vidyate. The rasas derived from our feelings in social life, in family life, or in the greater family life of altruism, philanthropy, nationalism, socialism, communism, etc., do not guarantee that one's next life will be as a human being. Hare Krishna. But Bhakti Rasa guarantees. Even a little bit of this Bhakti Rasa you practiced, your next human form is guaranteed. We prepare our next life by our actual activities in the present life. Karmana Daiva Netrena Jantur Deho Papattaye. By the superior authority known as Daiva, bodies are allocated. Daiva is explained as destiny. Daiva supervision gives us a body selected from 8.4 million forms. The choice does not depend on our selection. It's natural selection. Not the Darwin's way. God's way. Natural in the sense, nature that is controlled, Prakruti, is making that selection for us. But based on God's intervention. So last line of that paragraph, therefore, you understand therefore means Prabhupada was building a case till now to make a point. All bona fide activities in Krishna consciousness are amrita or permanent. This is the subject matter of Nectar of Devotion, Bhakti Rasa Amrita Sindhu. So till now we discussed Bhakti Rasa, then we discussed Amrita. Now, we will further elaborate on the flavors of Bhakti Rasa and the pleasure that it awards you. So that's what we'll begin now. The eternal engagement in Bhakti Rasa can be understood by a serious student. Are you serious? Adoption of Bhakti Rasa will immediately bring one to an auspicious life, Shubhada, free from anxieties, Kleshaghni, and will bless us with transcendental existence, thus minimizing the value of liberation, Moksha Laghuta Akrut. Bhakti Rasa itself is sufficient to produce a feeling of liberation. Wow! Because it attracts the attention of the Supreme Lord Krishna. generally neophyte devotees are anxious to see Krishna, but God cannot be seen or known by our present materially blunt senses. The process of devotional service, as it is recommended in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, will gradually elevate one from the material condition of life to the spiritual status, wherein the devotee becomes purified of all designations. Sarvopadhi vinirmuktam. The senses can then become uncontaminated. Tatparatvena nirmalam. Tatpara means fully engaged in service. And nirmala means uncontaminated senses. Being constantly in touch with bhakti rasa, senses become uncontaminated, nirmala. When the purified senses are employed in the service of the Lord, rushikena rushikesha sevanam, one becomes situated in bhakti rasa life. Wow. And any action performed for the satisfaction of Krishna in this transcendental bhakti rasa stage of life can be relished perpetually. Amruta. Okay, so this is the Sarvopadhi Vinirmuktam Tatparatvena Nirmalam Rushikena Rushikesha Sevanam Bhakti Ruchyate, being described in amazing English. Proper explanation of that verse. Now, when one is thus engaged in devotional service, all varieties of rasas turn into eternity. Interesting information. See, we are relishing varieties of rasas, but are they turning into eternity? No. They are chapal sukh. So we enjoyed some little thing here, little thing there, and we are trying our best to enjoy our life. So it says, no. Engage in devotional service. The very same things in material life that you wanted to relish, now in connection with Krishna, will become immortal. That's an interesting option. Earlier we liked food, dance, music, poetry, studying literatures. We liked association of like-minded people. We liked some adventurous activities, trekking, you know. Now when connected with Krishna, that earlier pleasure that we derived out of viryaras, hasyaras, whatever, will now become amruta. So that is the nature of bhakti yoga. All varieties of rasas turn into eternity. In the beginning, one is trained according to the principles of regulation, under the guidance of acharya. Vaidhi sadhana bhakti. Gradually, when one is elevated, devotional service becomes automatic and spontaneous. Eagerness to serve Krishna. Raga anuga bhakti. There are 12 kinds of rasas, as will be explained in this book. Now, next word is very interesting. And by renovating our relationship with Krishna, renovating our relationship with Krishna, only Prabhupada can do such things. In 5 primary rasas, we can live eternally in full knowledge and bliss. So, what are the 12 rasas? First, 5 primary rasas. Shantya, Dasya, Sakhya, Vada. Madhurya. Shantya means awe and reverence. One is absorbed in thinking of the greatness of the Lord. God is great. Dasya rasa means God is my master. Sakya rasa means God is my friend. Matsalya means God is my child, or I am child of God. And then Madhurya rasa, God is my beloved lover. Like the Sufi songs, you know, Sufis are very, they treat God as a Rajkumar, who is a very intoxicating personality, and they write such literature, you can get bewildered on what they are writing. Anyways, so These are five primary rasas. What are the seven secondary rasas? Hasya, laughter. Then Raudra. Rudra means anger. Then Bibhatsa. Bibhatsa is abhorring something. I don't like it. Bibhatsa. Then Bhayanaka. Horror. Terrified. Virya means chivalrous, fighting mood. And Adbhuta, wonder. One more. Karuna. Daya or Karuna. Karuna means compassion. So why we go to movies? Why we watch TV? Why we read newspapers, magazines, Harry Potter? Why do we read novels and all kinds of things? Why? Rasa! One word explanation. Not very long. We want Rasa! We want Rasa! We want Rasa! That's what the soul is doing all the time. So material nature has got varieties to offer. Varieties, but having these three qualities. Bhogatyaga chapala sukha, terminated by death. So one should learn, one should become expert in denying the interest of the senses. And one should also become expert in fulfilling the interest of the soul. Swarthagati. Tate vidu swarthagatim hi Vishnum. Vishnu is our swarthagati. So, where do you get rasa from?
From all the
tanmatra. No, not really. Does gulab jamun have rasa? No, even mundane rasa, is it in gulab jamun? Gulab jamun is matter, no? It's in the mind. We are imagining that we are enjoying this. Because there are some fellows who don't like gulab jamun. Interesting. Same stuff. One person enjoys, another person... Why? Because it's in the mind. Manasijam. It's not in the substance. So the gulab jamun may look like whatever it is. It's just chemicals. Matter. That does not have any kind of... at such a particular thing. But we imagine it to be existing. Because we have trained our mind in the past by our desires and our actions. Samskaras created by past purva karma give us a particular inclination for enjoyment. So this is about... So where is rasa? Let's come back to that question. Where is rasa? Where is rasa? What's the first line of this book? Akhila rasamruta murti. Who? Krishna. Krishna is Rasaraj. Krishna is Rasavigraha. Akhila rasa amruta murti. He is the embodiment of all rasas. All rasas come from Krishna. So you want those seven secondary, five primary. Where do you go? Krishna. Don't go anywhere else. So that's the subject matter of this book. This is being hammered again and again. Don't look here and there. Go to Krishna. That is where you will find your fulfillment of rasa. So these are the 12 rasas. And movies, especially in modern times, they have really exploited the masses in making huge amounts of money. Because the masses are not having Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu book with them. Unfortunately, people are running after rasa in wrong place. So any movie you watch typically has Hasyaras, Karunaras, Bibhatsaras, Bhayanakaras, whatever. And the more Karunaras, the ladies will pay more, you know, to get a black ticket. The more Viryaras, the teenagers would go and pay more money, you know, to get the rasa. Of course, Shringararas, Madhurya is like a baseline of everything most of the time. So this is what they are doing, permutation combination of these rasas. And those movie producers that are expert in producing rasas through the permutation combination of the characters, their interactions and the activities, that much they become successful in their money making. So Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu can save a lot of your money by giving you a clue where to look for rasa in life, and the extra money you can give for book distribution or so distributing Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu to others. So by renovating our relationship with Krishna in five primary rasas, we can live eternally in full knowledge and bliss. Now someone may say, I just don't like to love anybody, I love myself. The basic principle of the living condition is that we have a general propensity to love someone. No one can live without loving someone else. Very bold statement. Somebody may say, there are criminals in Tihar jail or Yeroda nearby. What's the relevance of that statement to them? They just hate everybody. Sometimes they are. How do you justify this statement? No one can live without loving someone else. Yes. Yeah, but there are criminals who don't have wife, children, nothing. They just, they have become, in Marathi they call niradhavlela. He has become like a stone practically. Okay, he loves himself. Yes. Oh, criminals generally don't have cats and dogs in the jail. They have? Oh, really?
No, these are activities.
Okay.
Prabhuji, even the act of humanity that they must have done because they dug somebody and they
came. Okay. Actually, this kind of stone-heartedness is another symptom of lust. Earlier there is love. Now the same vector, equal in magnitude, opposite in direction, is lust. So love makes us very sensitive and lust makes us very desensitized. The more we become lusty, it's perversion of that original loving propensity in full scale. And then a person appears to be not having any emotions, not involving any, but that is not his true condition. Just like water when frozen becomes ice. But that's not natural condition of water. So like that, love transforms into lust. So even they have love, but misdirected. This propensity is present in every living being. Even an animal like a tiger has this loving propensity, at least in a dormant stage. And it is certainly present in the human beings. The missing point, however, is where to repose our love so that everyone can become happy. Prabhupada didn't say where to repose our love so that I can become happy. Or the object of love can become happy. So everyone can become happy. At the present moment, the human society teaches one to love his country or family or his personal self. The me generation. But there is no information where to repose the loving propensity so that everyone can become happy. This missing point is Krishna. And Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu teaches us how to stimulate our original love for Krishna. Word is important, stimulate. And how to be situated in that position where we can enjoy our blissful life. So what do you mean stimulate? Something that already exists. It just needs a little priming.
Okay. First he said renovate.
Yeah, first renovate, then stimulate. Interesting words. Okay, we are going good. In the primary stage, a child loves his parents, then his brothers. First he loves himself only. Annamaya kosh ke time is just me and everything mine. Then maybe parents, then brothers, then sisters. And as he daily grows up, he begins to love his family, society, community, country, nation, even the whole human society. But what a line. The loving propensity is not satisfied even by loving all human society. That loving propensity remains imperfectly fulfilled until we know who is the supreme beloved. Our love can be fully satisfied only when it is reposed in Krishna. This theme is the sum and substance of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, which teaches us how to love Krishna in five different transcendental rasas. So one time Brahmananda Swami, that time Bruce, was looking down at the street, busy New York street, many attractive men, women going by. And Prabhupada came over and he looked. And Prabhupada said, he turned towards Prabhupada. Prabhupada, is there no true love in this world? He asked a question. Prabhupada became very grave. Love? There is no love in this material world. Only love is when you love Krishna. So it was difficult for him to take it. Just like for most of us, it is difficult to take it in the first go. But Prabhupada, what happens between a man and woman? Isn't that love? That is cheating. This is too much. Then Prabhupada comes over. You want to enjoy that relationship? It is called lust. Take anyone from the street and enjoy. So it was like a shocking treatment for Bruce. Earlier Bruce, you remember the story where he had his wallet in which he carried the girlfriend's photo from India. And first time he met Prabhupada, they said, I have been to India. Prabhupada said, really? What did you do there? So I had a girlfriend there. So really? I still have her photo in my wallet. Can I see? So he gives the wallet and the girlfriend's photo. And Prabhupada looks very, very keenly. Indian girls are much more beautiful than that. He gives back. And with that one statement, all his attachment to that girl is shattered. This is over. After that, he never turned back into that direction. So this is Prabhupada's, So anyways, the point is, it is very important that we learn how to, first of all, how to learn to satisfy the tendency to love someone, where to repose it. At least theoretical conviction we should carry in the heart. Now someone may say, but Prabhu, Subhadra and Arjuna, their pure devotees, they also loved each other. Isn't that true love? Or we hear so many stories. Bhima loved Draupadi very much. He couldn't tolerate Draupadi's anguish and unhappiness. He wanted to always please her somehow or other. So isn't that love? Yes, that is love. Arjuna cried when Abhimanyu died. Isn't that love? Yes, that is love. But that loving propensity was channelized through Krishna. So that point will come in the next paragraph. Our loving propensity expands just as a vibration of light or air expands. But we do not know where it ends. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu teaches us the science of loving every one of the living entities perfectly by the easy method of loving Krishna. We have failed to create peace and harmony in human society, even by such great attempts as the United Nations, because we do not know the right method. The method is very simple, but one has to understand it with a cool head. Prabhupada is... The Nectar of Devotion teaches all men how to perform the simple and natural method of loving Krishna. If we learn how to love Krishna, then it is very easy to immediately and simultaneously love every living being. Immediately and simultaneously. It is like pouring water on the root of the tree or supplying food to the one's stomach. The method of pouring water on the root of the tree or supplying foodstuffs to the stomach is universally scientific and practical, as every one of us has experienced. Everyone knows well that when we eat something, the energy created by such action is immediately distributed throughout the whole body. Similarly, when we pour water on the root, energy created thus is immediately distributed throughout the entirety of even the largest tree. It is not possible to water the tree part by part, nor is it possible to feed the different parts of the body separately. You know, you can't put food in the ears, eyes, nose. So Prabhupada gives this analogy for two purposes. There is only one hole through which you can feed the body. In the same way, there is only through Guru Parampara that you can feed or serve Krishna. So, same extension of the analogy. The Nectar of Devotion will teach us how to turn the one switch that will immediately brighten everything, everywhere. One who does not know this method is missing the point of life. So how many of you have master switches in your home? You know, you just go and switch one up, everything becomes lit up. So Prabhupada is saying that as an example for just lit up Krishna consciousness in your life. You will become true lover of every other person in your vicinity. One time His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj gave an interesting definition of what is the meaning of God realization. He said God realization means to see everything happening around you as a way of bringing you closer to God. To see every moment as an opportunity to give and receive pure love with whoever you are interacting at the moment. And to see the entire material world, entire creation, as paraphernalia meant to serve God. That is God realization. First is to see everything happening around you as arrangement to bring you closer to God. Then to see every moment as an opportunity to give and take pure love. And then to see the whole material creation as a paraphernalia meant to serve God. So I think that's self-development, loving relationships, service contribution. You know, in the three stages. Now somebody may say, itna bhakti, bhakti, bhakti. Material life ka kuch hai ki nahi? Huh? One of the blames on ISKCON typically has been that these people are too otherworldly. Huh? they don't, as far as material necessities are concerned, aage topic, the human civilization at the present moment is very much advanced in living comfortably, but still we are not happy because we are missing the point. The material comforts of life alone are not sufficient to make us happy. The vivid example is the bad boy in the class, America. The richest nation in the world, having all facilities for material comfort, is producing a class of men completely confused and frustrated in life. I am appealing herewith. It's like a Prabhupada is sitting on top of some White House or something, you know, and giving a, I am appealing herewith to such confused men to learn the art of devotional service as directed in the Nectar of Devotion, and I am sure the fire of material existence burning within their hearts will be immediately extinguished. The root cause of our dissatisfaction is that our dormant loving propensity has not been fulfilled despite our great advancement in the materialistic way of life. Nectar of Devotion will give us practical hints how we can live in this material world perfectly engaged in devotional service and thus fulfill all our desires in this life and next, even material desires. The Nectar of Devotion is not presented to condemn any way of materialistic life. Note that point. This book doesn't do that. But the attempt is to give information to religionists, philosophers, and people in general how to love Krishna. One may live without material discomfiture. Prabhupada kahan kahan se word dhoond-dhoond ke laate hai. But at the same time, he should learn the art of loving Krishna. Art of loving, not art of living. Art of living means how to live material life without material discomfiture. But art of loving means art of loving Krishna. So there was a statement I heard by Socrates, I think. The secret of change is not to put your energy in fighting the old, but in building the new. The secret of change is not to put your energy in fighting the old, but in building the new. So many times we are frustrated with our past. Something has happened, and we keep thinking how that can be set right. Put your energy in building the new. Start loving Krishna. At the present moment, we are inventing so many ways to utilize our propensity to love. YouTube and, you know, mobile technology, Facebook. But factually, we are missing the real point, Krishna. We are watering all parts of the tree, but missing the tree's root. We are trying to keep our body fit by all means, but we are neglecting to supply foodstuffs to the stomach. Missing Krishna means missing one's self also. Real self-realization and realization of Krishna go together simultaneously. For example, seeing oneself in the morning means seeing the sunrise also. Self-realization and sun-realization. God-realization. Without seeing the sunshine, no one can see himself. Similarly, unless one has realized Krishna, there is no question of self-realization. This is called as drishtanta, ability to give analogies that make a philosophical point very clear, without ambiguity. The Nectar of Devotion is specifically presented for persons who are now engaged in the Krishna Consciousness movement, which means this book is to be distributed to internal audience of ISKCON to be studied by them. I beg to offer my sincere thanks to all my friends and disciples who are helping me push forward this Krishna consciousness movement. Especially Shriman Jayananda Brahmachari. You know, he used to drive taxi in New York City. And whatever money he used to get, he would give it to Prabhupada at the end of the day. And he did that for many days, till he was appointed as temple president. To do more service. My thanks are due as well to the directors of ISKCON Press, who have taken so much care in publishing this great literature. Hare Krishna. A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami. April 13, 1970, ISKCON Headquarters, Watseka Avenue, Los Angeles, California. I had been to that room where this book was written recently. Beautiful place to go.
Exactly.
Today is 12th April. Congratulations. Krishna is pleased with us, it seems. Any comments or questions so far?
I think in the introduction of Bhagavad Gita, Prabhupada mentioned bhakti as purified activity. But here he seems to be calling it devotional service. Like,
yes. Yes. So basically this preface was about the history, the why, what, how of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. So why to study the book? What is the book all about? Bhakti Rasa Amrita Sindhu. And then how one can experience change of heart while studying this book. What will exactly happen? So this is preface. Now comes introduction. Now this introduction is also the introduction of Rupa Goswami to the book. So we will read the Sanskrit and then read the English. Please repeat. Akhila Rasamrita Murtihi Prasru Mararuchiru Dhatara Kapalihi Kalita Shama Lalito Radha Preyan Vidhur Jayati. Translation.
Invoking auspiciousness. Lord Sri Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the cause of all causes, the reservoir of all rasas.
Akhila Rasamrita Murti.
Or relationships, which are called neutrality, passive adoration, servitorship, friendship, parenthood, conjugal love, comedy. Compassion.
Comedy.
Fear. Chivalry. Ghastliness. Wonder. And devastation.
Interesting rasa. Devastation. How many of you love devastation? There are people who like it. They feel excited when they are devastated.
Devastation of the enemy.
No. Self-devastation also.
They like it?
They like it. There are people who are in depression, they like to stay in depression. They enjoy that rasa of being deprived, etc. Go ahead.
He is the supreme attractive form, and by his universal and transcendental attractive features, he has captivated all the gopis, headed by Taraka, Palika, Shama, Lalita, and ultimately Srimati Radharani.
So, Prasrumara, Ruchi, Ruddha. By spreading the taste of his own attractiveness, like a trap, basically, he has captured these big-time devotees. Taraka, Pali, Shama, you know, Kalita Shama, Lalita, and Radha. Taraka, Palika, Shama, Lalita, and ultimately Srimati Radharani. So, this Vidhur Jayati, Vidhu means bridegroom. Vidhu means moon also. Bhaja Godruma Kanana Kunja Vidhum. So, Vidhu means moon. So, may this moon Be always victorious. Vidhur Jayati.
Let His Lordship's grace be on us so that there may not be any hindrance in the execution of this duty of writing the nectar of devotion. Impelled by His divine grace, Sri Srimad Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada.
So Prabhupada is writing about His Guru Maharaj because this is a summary study. So He can take that liberty. So this let His grace be on us is not exactly in the context of this verse, but Prabhupada is making that prayer to Krishna, that He is the subject matter of this book, He is the main hero, and what is His quality? Akhila Rasa Amrita Murti, embodiment of all rasa, and He is expert at capturing somebody by His attractiveness. So these are the characteristics of the Lord. Krishna, all attractive, all encapturing in the context of this verse. Now we begin the second verse. Rudeyasya prerenaya pravartito ham varakarupopi tasya hare padakamalam vande chaitanya devasya. Next paragraph.
Let me offer my respectful obeisances unto the lotus feet of Srila Rupa Goswami Prabhupada and of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Prabhupada, by whose inspiration I have been engaged in the matter of compiling this summary study of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu.
So this is Prabhupada's personal addition. Next.
This is the sublime science of devotional service as propounded by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who appeared 500 years ago in West Bengal, India, to propagate the movement of Krishna consciousness.
So none of these things are there in the shloka. It's not like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared 500 years ago in Bengal. That doesn't come in the shloka here. It says, Hrudi Yasya Prerenaya. Rupa Goswami is saying, by the prerana, inspiration of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in my heart, pravartitaha aham, I am now engaged. Although varaka rupopi, although I am most abominable, varaka. But tasya harehe padakamalam vande chaitanya devasya. That Lord Hari, who has appeared as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I offer my obeisances at His lotus feet before I begin this work. Now, there is Sanatana Goswami, who is the guru of Rupa Goswami. Although he was his elder brother, he treated him like a guru. So he offers prayers to his spiritual master. Vishrama Mandiratya Tasya Sanatana Tanor Madishasya Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhur Bhavatu Sadayam Pramodaya. Translation. Third paragraph.
Srila Rupa Goswami begins his great book by offering his respectful obeisances unto Sri Sanatana Goswami, who is his elder brother and spiritual master, and he prays that Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu may be very pleasing to him. He further prays that by residing in that ocean of nectar, Sri Sanatana Goswami may always feel transcendental pleasure in the service of Radha and Krishna.
So this verse has many meanings. First is, if the Sanatana refers to Lord Krishna, who is the eternal supreme Lord, then the meaning becomes Madhishasya, my Lord, Sanatana, Lord Krishna. May this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu become Sada Ayam Pramodaya. May this book give great pleasure constantly to this Lord of mine. So that's one meaning. Now if you say Sanatana as Sanatana Goswami, his guru, then again the meaning becomes same, that my Lord, Madhishasya, my supreme spiritual master, Sanatana Goswami, may this book bring great delight to his heart. Pramoda means happiness. Sada ayam pramodaya, constant happiness to his heart. So he prays that may this book, just like I'll give a visual. How many of you have gone into some lake or some artificial body of water with some, you know, there are those tires kind of tires, and you go and lie in the tire and kind of float around?
It's called the lazy river.
It's in the water.
It's usually in the water
parks. Okay. So you go and... So this is called Vishrama Mandiratya. May like that, Sanatan Goswami delight in this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. It's an interesting way of, you know. Can you imagine how much the devotee wants to really please their spiritual master? You know, I'm writing a book. What is my understanding of writing this book? May this book writing bring great pleasure to my spiritual master. Same with all of our other activities that we do. I'm cooking, I'm speaking, I'm whatever. Video recording. You know, may this bring great pleasure. May my spiritual master float in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the ocean of transcendental bliss of Bhakti that I am performing. And may he relish this. That's the mood in the shloka. Okay. These are my personal explanations. They are not given by any acharyas. Let me clarify that. Now, the next verse. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhau Charataha. Paribhuta Kala Jalabhiyaha. Bhaktamakaran Ashilita. Mukti Nadikan Namasami. Translation.
Let us offer our respectful obeisances to all the great devotees and acharyas, holy teachers, who are compared to the sharks in the great ocean of nectar and who do not care for the various rivers of liberation. Impersonalists are very fond of...
Just hold. So what it says here, this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is an ocean, right? So what do you find in an ocean?
Sharks.
So who are the sharks swimming in this ocean of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu? The great devotees and acharyas. Bhakta Makaran. Makara means shark. Makara Kundale Talapat. No, Makara. Bhakta Makaran, they are called sharks. So the sharks go, you know, swim. They are just delighting, being in their natural condition in the ocean. Like that, the devotees are delighting in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. And these sharks, they do not care for the various rivers of liberation. Mukti Nadikan Namasami. Ashilita means they neglect. They find no delight there. So have you ever seen a shark in a river?
No.
He's always in the ocean. Right? I don't know if you have seen... devotees are capable of doing anything. But as of now, in this analogy, sharks are not seen in the rivers. So bhukti, mukti, siddhi are called like rivers. They ultimately merge into ocean of bhakti. All the attempts of all these bhakti kamis, mukti kamis, if they want to find their perfection, they have to come back here. Okay? So the sharks never go to the rivers. Means, devotees have no interest in bhakti, mukti, siddhi. Especially mukti, that river. They just hate it. Liberation of merging into Brahman. That devotees don't like at all. So he says, Bhakta Makaran Ashilita Mukti Nadikan Namasami. So though all these devotees I bow down to, because they don't like this river of Mukti. Now some twisted minded Mayavadi may give an explanation. The water of river, when it merges into the water of ocean, it becomes one. So in the same manner, those who practice whatever path that they practice, when they merge ultimately into the Supreme, they all become one, isn't it? Rupa Goswami says, no, there are fishes in the rivers. When the rivers come and merge into the ocean, those fishes retain their individuality even in the ocean. They don't merge with the ocean. Right? What to speak of that? Even the molecules of H2O in the rivers, when they come inside the ocean, they still retain their individuality as H2O molecules. This is our explanation. to that degree, we hate merging. You're getting what we are talking about? So we just don't appreciate this merging business. So that's the explanation followed next. Impersonalist, please read.
Impersonalists are very fond of merging into the Supreme, like rivers that come down and merge into the ocean. The ocean can be compared to liberation and the rivers to all different parts of liberation. The impersonalists are dwelling in the river water, which eventually come to mix with the ocean. They have no information, however, that within the ocean, as within the river, there are innumerable aquatic living entities. The sharks who dwell in the ocean do not care for the rivers, which are gliding down into it. The devotees eternally live in the ocean of devotional service, and they do not care for the rivers. In other words, those who are pure devotees always remain in the ocean of transcendental loving service to the Lord and have no business with the other processes, which are compared to the rivers that only gradually come to the ocean.
Joy. So how many of you felt happy about this analogy? So that means you are a devotee. You know, you should like this analogy very much. This is interesting. So the ocean is an analogy for Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Sharks are the devotees. They are not found in the rivers of Bhakti, Mukti and Siddhi. And the impersonalists, although they may say that we merge ultimately, that is not true. The fishes remain fishes there and here as well. So that's the analogy. Now the last verse for the day and then we conclude.
Mimamsak Badvagnehe Kathinam Api Kunthayannasau Spuratu Sanatana Suchiram Tava Bhakti Rasamrutam Bodhihi.
Translation.
Rupa Goswami prays to his spiritual master, Sri Sanatana Goswami, for the protection of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, the ocean of the pure nectar of devotional service, from the argumentative logicians who unnecessarily meddle in the science of service to the Lord. He compares their argument and logic to volcanic eruptions in the midst of the ocean. In the midst of the ocean, volcanic eruptions can do very little harm. And similarly, those who are against devotional service to the Lord and who put forward many philosophical theses about the ultimate transcendental realization cannot disturb this great ocean of devotional service.
So Badavagni means volcanic eruption. Mimamsaka means those who are dry logicians and argumentative fellows. They, when they study Vedic literatures or any proposition of Bhakti Yoga, they start putting forward their logic. So they are called Mimamsaka Badavagne. Their dry logic that they are trying to apply to this Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu is like a volcanic eruption below the ocean bed. So what happens to the ocean? Nothing. In the same manner, may Sanatana Goswami empower this book to become such a beautiful book that no dry logician can play with the words of this book and give a misconstrued interpretation, meaning to this book. Please spare my book, you rascals, Mayavadis. That's what in short he's saying. That I don't want this book to be meddled by them. They can meddle. Maybe Vedanta Sutras they meddled with. Okay, they even meddled with Bhagavatam, which is not their territory. But I strongly, this is the mood of Rupa Goswami. I don't want these guys to come and give explanation of my book anymore. Because this is a book meant for only devotees who can relish Bhakti Rasa. So that's the mood. And he's praying to his Guru Maharaj that please protect my book from these guys. So that's the mood. Spuratu Sanatana Suchiram tava bhakti rasam bodhi. And what is the nature of these mimamsakas? They are always in kuntha. They're themselves miserable, and by giving explanations and misguiding people, they make everybody else also miserable. Kathinam api kunthayan naso. This is their business. Klesho adhikatarastesham avyakta asakta chetasam avyakta hi gatir dukham dehavad bhirvapyate. Krishna is already saying this is a miserable path, mukti path. You know, it's not like bhakti. So Rupa Goswami wants that this book be not played around by these people, mimamsakas. One more. Bhakti rasasya prastutir akhila jagan mangala prasangasya adnenapi mayasya kriyate suhrudam pramodaya. Next paragraph.
The author of Bhakti Samrit Sindhu, Srila Rupa Goswami, very humbly submits that he is just trying to spread Krishna consciousness all over the world, although he humbly thinks himself unfit for this work. That should be the attitude of all creatures of the Krishna conscious movement, following in the footsteps of Srila Rupa Goswami. We should never think of ourselves as great creatures, but should always consider that we are simply instrumental to the previous acharyas.
So bhakti rasasya prastuti. This book is nothing but bhakti rasa prastuti. Akhila jangan, akhila jagan mangala prasangasya. For what purpose? To benefit the suffering humanity, to bring all auspiciousness to it. I have written this book. What is my qualification? Adnenapi. I am adnyana. I am not a very qualified person, ignorant person. Maya asya kriyate. Still I am trying to write this book. For what? Surudam pramodaya. Just to give happiness to devotees of the Lord, like all of you. So that's for the readers. So he began with Krishna, then he glorified Radharani and all the intoxicated devotees of Krishna. Then he glorified his spiritual master, of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then Sanatana Goswami. Then he glorified the book that he's about to write. He's like an ocean and devotees are like sharks. And then he made a prayer that my book be protected from mimamsakas. I don't want him to meddle with my book, giving misconstrued explanations of my book. And finally, he praises the readers. I am writing this book for your pleasure. Please study very nicely. So these are the six beginning verses. They convey the subject of the book. Who is the subject? Bhakti Rasa and Lord Krishna. Then they convey the Mangala Charana, invoking auspiciousness. And they also talk about the benedictions on those who study the book. So we will continue next time. Any comments or questions? So please make sure you have your own personal copy and this book only. Huh? No different books in the class. Better take this one so that we are all on the same page. How many of you are okay with this venue? Wow. Surudam Pramodaya. You have started this endeavor. You have to be ultimately pleased. Okay. And you have. This is the largest place you can get in this temple. Maybe I'll go back a little more and we can next time arrange the chairs a little more separate from each other. Any other concerns? Okay. So just see the prasadam arrangement. So I want to once again encourage everyone to start studying this book at home. Every time you come in the class, please read the things that are coming ahead. This is the format we will be going through the book. I personally feel that this format makes many things clear. We also get to know what Prabhupada added. We also get to know why he added that to the book. At the same time, we also get the flow of the book the way Rupa Goswami has given it, without losing the track. Thank you all very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu ki jai, Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bol.